Okay, I think we'll make a start now. In the last lecture, I introduced you to stereographic projections, and today I've given you one of these Wulff nets to practice with if you want. And you can get more of these from the class technician if you need them. Okay. One of the applications of the stereographic projection was, for example, to plot how the elastic modulus varies as function of orientation, and another to look at how symmetry can be represented on the stereographic projection. And here, for example, we have a point group 3m, and the point group 3m belongs to the trigonal system. And basically, we have a threefold axis and a mirror plane parallel to the threefold axis, and because we have a threefold axis, you end up with these three mirror planes. Okay, and notice one thing, that obviously when we are drawing the stereographic projection, there are lines, but to represent mirror planes, you use bold lines. Okay, so on all the diagrams that you have in your notes, whenever you have a stereographic projection like this, the mirror planes are drawn in bold. Okay? Okay, now supposing that I place a point at an arbitrary location inside a cell with this point group symmetry. So an arbitrary location means that there is no particular symmetry element passing through it apart from a monad. A monad is just a one-fold rotation axis, it doesn't do anything. Okay, so I place a point at a location where we have just a one axis passing through it, then the operation of the triad will produce this and this, and the operation of the mirror planes will produce the other three. So if we place an atom at a location which has a symmetry 1 in a cell with a point group symmetry 3m, then we expect to see 6 of those atoms inside the cell. Okay, so that's quite important when you're solving structures, because you can of course verify how many atoms you have inside the cell by measuring the lattice parameters and working out the density of your material. Okay, so if you place atoms at particular positions, you should expect to see a certain number of atoms in the cell. Everyone happy with that? Okay. Now, one further thing to notice here is that all of these poles, if you like, are pointing upwards. There's nothing downwards because there isn't a center of symmetry in this. Okay. So what that means is that going along this direction is not the same as going in the opposite direction. So these are called polar groups, where you do not have a center of symmetry here, and you don't see any circles below these points. Okay, so I'll give you an example of a polar group. 3m is obviously one polar group, but 6mm is also a polar group, and 6mm represents the gallium nitride that goes into your light emitting diodes in your bicycles and so on. It's a hexagonal form of gallium nitride. We did the diamond form of gallium nitride when I was introducing structures, but actually it's the hexagonal form which is used in light emitting diodes. And the z-axis there represents the six-fold axis, and you can see that the structure at the top is not the same as the structure at the bottom. Okay, so when you are depositing gallium nitride, you know, you hope that you get just one of these layers and not a mixture of this layer and this layer, because that would influence the electrical properties. It would be regarded as a defect. Okay, so you've got a thin layer of gallium nitride, you want the same structure everywhere and not bits of this and bits of this. So this is a polar material, and you can clearly see that things are not the same in the z direction as in the minus z direction. Everyone happy with that? So again, there's a no center of symmetry. If you look in your table, you'll see that this is classified in the non-centrosymmetric group. there we are. We have the table here, and you can see that 6mm here is in the non-centrosymmetric, and 3m is also in the non-centrosymmetric set. Okay, in your notes, that's rather strange. Sorry?
There was a problem with that in the last lecture as well.
Okay.
It should be fine in
that. It'll go. 10 seconds or so. Okay, okay. Now, in your notes, after discussing the gallium nitride, I go on to talk about pyrite, right? If you look at the diagrams that are in your note, the figure, what figure number is this?
2.9.
Yeah, 2.9 C and D are about pyrite, but I'm going to reserve that to the end and go on to discuss this titanate. It's a lead titanate. Can you tell me what kind of a cell this is? It's tetragonal, you're told that, but is it primitive or not? Can you look at it and tell me whether it's primitive or not? And notice that the atoms are placed peculiarly, right? So this is a height of 0.572 and this is at 0.116. So what kind of a cell is this? Primitive, right? Yeah. The symmetries. Let's see what symmetry do you symmetry element. So tetragonal means we have to look at the highest order axis along the z direction. So what is that axis? Yeah. What kind of a rotation axis? Yeah, tetrad. Okay, so we've got a fourfold axis that way. And what about symmetry elements normal along x and y? Yeah, there's a dyad, but is there a higher symmetry element? You're right, because these are rectangular faces. Mirror planes? Yeah, okay. So the point group symmetry for this would be 4mm. Okay. Now let's see whether the structure that I showed you in the previous diagram is consistent with the placing of atoms inside the cell. So in this first stereographic projection, I've got these two mirror planes in bold lines, and we've got a fourfold axis in the middle, and I place a point, a general point, x, y, z, which just has a monad passing through it. If I do that, then I will produce four of these atoms inside the cell. And once the mirrors are operated, there will be eight of these atoms inside the cell. And if you go back to this image, we've got basically one of these lead atoms, okay? One titanium atom, and that's 3 plus 4 oxygen atoms, okay? So that would be inconsistent, that none of these atoms are located at a point where the symmetry is just a monad, okay? So we can rule that out. This is just showing you the fourfold axis in the middle and the mirror planes. These two mirror planes, and these arise naturally, you can see there, okay? So 4mm describes the complete symmetry of that cell. So a general location where the site symmetry is 1 would require 8 such atoms in the cell, and therefore we have no atom in the cell which is located at a general point. Now, if I place an atom on the mirror plane itself, okay, then I would just end up with 4, okay? So I'm putting it at an arbitrary location on the mirror plane, then I would end up with 4 because there's a tetrad in the middle, right? So those are your 4 oxygen atoms. And if I place it so that the atom is actually on the face and on the mirror plane, then you would end up with just one, which is your lead atom. Okay? Now, some nice people have worked out the multiplicity of atoms as a function of the symmetry of the site at which you place the atom. So all these tables can be found in the international tables of crystallography, very, very well established stuff, which you can also find on the web. I've simplified this. This shows that if I place an atom where the site symmetry is 1, I will end up with 8 atoms in the cell. If I place an atom at a location where the site symmetry is 4 mm, that means I've got a tetrad passing through it, which would be the oxygen or the, not the lead or the titanium atom has a tetrad passing through it, okay, and mirrors, then I will end up with just one of those atoms. So these have a tetrad passing through it, and so does this, and two mirror planes at 90 degrees, so you would end up with just one such atom in the cell. Is everyone happy with that? Okay, you can see that clearly. So, supposing that you are solving for a structure, because you know diffraction gives you a certain amount of information, but it doesn't tell you exactly where the atoms are unless you look at intensities and so on. So sometimes what you have to do is you have to guess a structure and then calculate the intensities of diffracted waves and see if everything is consistent. And that's why it's very difficult to solve complex structures, and you get Nobel Prizes for solving the structure of DNA and so forth. So things like these international tables from the International Union of Crystallography are very helpful, because you guess a structure and then you see whether the density of your material, other characteristics, piezoelectricity, etc., are consistent with your guess structure. And eventually you arrive with a complete fit. Okay, so is everyone happy with that? Okay, now if you look at all these stereographic projections, you don't see any circles underneath, right? So again, this material does not have a center of symmetry, and it is in fact piezoelectric. So if you stress it, then the atoms don't move equally. And you develop a charge. The titanium atom doesn't move the same as the lead atom, and therefore you develop a charge. Okay. So this is a particularly simple example. As you go to crystals with lower and lower symmetry, there are many, many possibilities that arise, but they have all been tabulated for you. So I don't expect you to remember this, but for a simple structure, you should be able to deduce the number of atoms that should exist in the cell. Okay? Okay, now I said to you that the lead titanate is piezoelectric. It doesn't have a center of symmetry. And there are other consequences about whether a material has a center of symmetry or not, which you may not imagine but are related to crystallography. So when we talk about the free energy of a solution, we usually assume that your solution is homogeneous, right? That it's got a certain chemical composition. But if there is a variation of composition inside the solution, then the free energy is not a particular value, but it depends also. So this is the free energy of a homogeneous solution, and you have these additional terms which depend on the gradient of concentration variation. Okay, so here for example, this is the gradient as a function of concentration as a function of distance, the d squared c by dz squared and dc by dz squared. Now, just look at this equation and tell me which term should be missing if my crystal has a center of symmetry. Okay. So we've got here the free energy varying as a function of gradient in the first term, second derivative of gradient, and the gradient squared. One of those terms should not exist if your crystal has a center of symmetry. Yeah, because you're right. Yeah, you know, the free energy in a centrosymmetric material should not vary with direction, right? And therefore, the second term there, kappa 1 into the gradient, you can just delete that for a centrosymmetric system. So it isn't just about piezoelectricity and ferroelectricity and so on, but even your elementary thermodynamics of solutions depends on whether your system has a center of symmetry or not. Okay, so I gave you a simple example, which is the lead titanate, in which we saw that the symmetry of the site at which an atom is located determines the number of atoms inside the unit cell, and those multiplicities are all tabulated for you in the international tables. Now I want to show you an example where this simple analysis fails, because we are not taking account of translations. Okay, in considering point groups, you are not taking account of translations. And what I'm doing is I'm setting up the scene for a future lecture in which we'll deal with not point groups but space groups. Space groups include translations as well. So this is a pyrite, which is iron sulfide and also known as fool's gold, because it looks like gold but it's actually iron sulfide. And you've got a projection of the cell on the right hand side, and the stereographic projection showing you the point group of the lattice, which is M3. This is cubic. Okay. Now you can see that the structure satisfies the formula FeS2, because you've got iron atoms at the corners and iron atoms at the centers of each of the faces. That means three from the faces and one from the corner. So we've got four iron atoms, and all the sulfur atoms are completely enclosed inside the cell, so there are eight of them. Now the sulfur atoms are located at positions where there isn't a particular symmetry element, in other words a monad, and according to the stereogram I should therefore, you know, if I place an atom at a general position, I should end up with 24 such possibilities, right? But I only have 8 inside the cell. And the reason is, you know, in the point group, things like glide planes and screw axes change into mirror planes and dyads, which don't actually exist in the structure. So if you look at this dashed line that's going through the cube parallel to the z-axis, then that's a glide plane, because look, if I take this sulfur atom at that location and that height and I reflect it, then I get another sulfur atom at the height 0.11. But then if I translate it vertically by half, you know, because I said to you that the translations are fractions of the repeat distance, then I recover the position at 0.61. So that's called a glide plane. You reflect and you translate parallel to the plane. If this was a mirror plane, I would have an atom at 0.11, not at 0.61, right? And that's not taken into account when we just look at point groups. This symbol here represents a screw axis, which is pointing out of the plane of the diagram. So if I take my atom here at 0.11, and I rotate it by 180 degrees, then I get to a position here at 0.11, and then I translate parallel to the axis by a half, which is half the repeat distance, and I get the atom at position 6.1. So in order to deal with structures like this, which have translational symmetry elements as well, in other words, screw axes and glide planes, we will have to think about space groups rather than point groups, and I'll come to that in a later lecture. Everyone happy with the screw axes and the glide planes? You can imagine how they operate? Okay, so changing the subject slightly, we did a cubic stereogram, and I showed you how to sketch the stereographic projection for the cube, and I'll just go through that again quickly. Okay, so to sketch the cubic stereogram, I begin by drawing a circle. Which represents the perimeter of the stereogram. So, to sketch the stereogram, I begin by drawing a circle which represents the equatorial plane. And then I want to identify the x and the y axes. So, I label this as 100 to follow convention, this one as 010, and the z axis is in the middle. Parallel to the North Pole, so it's 0, 0, 1. Now, the vector 0, 0, 1 is pointing out of the plane of the diagram, and 0, 1, 0 is pointing towards the right. If I add those two up, then I know that 0, 1, 1 must lie somewhere along this line, and I can fix that position by measuring using a Wulff net, which gives me 45 degrees here and 45 degrees here to mark 0, 1, 1, which is the sum of 0, 0, 1 and 0, 1, 0. There's no option. You have to determine the angle between this and this and then mark it off using a Wulff net. But we have a tetrad in the middle, a fourfold rotation axis. Which means that there must also be another 0, 1, 1 type direction here, here, and here. And similarly, at this location, this one here and here. So I'll just label the opposites, which is bar 1, 0, 0, and 0, bar 1, 0. So it follows that this one here will be the sum of 1, 0, 0, and 0, 1, 0, which will give me 1, 1, 0. On for this particular one, it'll be bar 1, 1, 0. This one will be bar 1, bar 1, 0. Here we have 1, bar 1, 0, adding these two up. And this one similarly is 0, bar 1, 1, 1, 0, 1, and bar 1, 0, 1. And I can draw, you can see that bar 101 is exactly at 90 degrees to 101. Because if I take a dot product of 101 with bar 101, that's 90 degrees. Therefore, the trace of the 101 pole must pass through bar 101. And similarly, the trace of the bar 101 plane will pass through 101. And I can draw the other traces. Here, that's the trace of the 011 pole, and this is the trace of the 0 bar 11 pole. Now, I'd like to plot where 111 is. If you look at this great circle here, then 111 must lie somewhere on there because 101 plus 010 gives me 11, so it must lie somewhere along here. But it also must lie somewhere on this great circle because 100 plus 011 gives me 111. So this is my triad, which is a 111. And similarly, I must have 1-1-1 type planes there, because they're the fourfold axis. And this one is given by 0-1-1 plus bar 1-0-0. So this is bar 1-1-1. Here we have bar 1-1. And this one will be 1-1-1. So this is the cubic stereogram. And it's important to note that a direction and a plane normal that have the same indices will plot on this stereogram at the same point. So, for example, this represents both the direction bar 1, 1, 0 and the plane normal bar 1, 1, 0. They are exactly parallel. And the second thing to note is that this stereographic projection is independent of the lattice parameter. Okay, independent of the lattice parameter. Because we are only plotting angular relationships. Angular relations. And for a cubic system, those angular relations do not change as a function of the lattice parameter. So we can do the cubic stereogram very easily. And although I'm referring to poles, this applies equally to directions, because in the cubic system, a 1-1-1 plane normal is exactly parallel to a 1-1-1 direction. Okay, so we have a single stereogram here for directions and for poles. And supposing I change the lattice parameter, will this, so let's say this is for a lattice parameter of 5 angstroms, supposing I change that to 10 angstroms, will this stereographic projection need to be plotted again? No, because the angular relationships are all retained, right? We are only plotting angles, we are not plotting distances. So for the cubic system, the stereographic projection applies to planes, it applies to directions, and irrespective of what the lattice parameter is. As soon as we deviate from the cubic system, that's no longer true. So you can see on this slide that this is my plane 1-1. This is the direction 1-1, and the direction 1-1 is not parallel to the normal to the 1-1 plane. So immediately, if you want to plot directions and planes for a non-cubic system, you will have to have separate stereograms or use separate symbols to identify directions and planes on the same stereographic projection. Okay? Is everyone happy with that? Okay, so here, for example, I have a cubic stereogram and an orthorhombic stereogram, and we are plotting plane normals. So in the case of the cube, you are familiar with this, and the plane normal to the 1-1 plane is exactly parallel to the 1-1 direction. But this is the orthorhombic lattice, and the angle here is 45 degrees, but the angle here will not be 45 degrees. This plane normal to the 1-1 will be closer to the 0-1-0 pole. So here you are. For example, if you look at the 0-0-1, the 0-1-1 and the 0-1, the angle here is 45 degrees and 45 degrees, but that no longer is the case for the orthorhombic cell. So the stereographic projection has now become a function of the lattice parameters as well. It's not the same for two orthorhombic crystals with different lattice parameters. Okay. So this shows you two orthorhombic cells, and they have different C parameters, and you can see that the stereographic projections are not identical. So the projection becomes a function of the lattice parameters. And this is orthorhombic, so all the angles between the basis vectors are 90 degrees. Okay, this slide illustrates that for the same lattice parameters, the stereographic projections for plane normals and directions look completely different, right? So here we have lattice parameters 2, 3, and 5 for the orthorhombic system, and these represent plane normals, and these represent directions. Okay. So clearly, directions are not parallel to plane normals with the same indices. So things become more complicated when we go to crystals of low symmetry, that we have to use two stereograms, one for directions, one for normals. And if you're plotting them on the same stereogram, then you need different symbols. I've used square symbols for directions and dots for plane normals. And of course, if I change the lattice parameters, then the the angular relationships all change, and therefore the stereographic projections will also change. This is now the hexagonal system, and the axes of the hexagonal cell are at 120 degrees to each other. These are the axes, x and y. They make an angle of 120 degrees. But very, very important for you to note, and this is a common mistake made by people, that the normals to the 100 and 010 planes are at 60 degrees to each other. Can you see that? This is the normal to the 100 plane, and this is the normal to the 010 plane. So on the stereographic projection, the normal to the 100 plane is actually at 60 degrees to the normal of the 010 plane. Is that clear to everyone? Yeah? I mean, I can draw it. So this is my unit cell, projection of the unit cell. This is 120 degrees. This is x and y. But the normal to this plane is here, and the normal to this plane is here, and the angle here is 60 degrees, okay? So beware of that when plotting a hexagonal stereogram. Okay, now there's another complication. If you look at this face here, and this face here, it's exactly crystallographically equivalent to this face here, okay? Exactly crystallographically equivalent. These are just the faces of the hexagon, right? And yet, you know, when I plot the normal to this face here, it has different indices. It's bar 1, 1, 0, instead of a permutation of 0, 1, and 0, right? So these are crystallographically equivalent faces, and yet they have different indices. Can you see that? So in order to cope with this, so we normally use Miller indices, and Miller was in our earth sciences department. So you can look up the history of the Miller indices over there in the Sidgwick Museum. To cope with the fact that crystallographically equivalent planes do not have the same permutation of indices, there was another set of indices defined called the Miller-Bravais indices. All right? So you can clearly see that crystallographically equivalent planes do not have the same indices. 1 bar 1, 0 is not a permutation of 0, 0, and 1. So if you want to say planes of the form 100, we would have this awkward mixture of indices. So what was done is to introduce a fourth index. And the fourth index works as follows. So we have the x-axis, we have the y-axis, and you have the t-axis going in that direction. So I've drawn it for clarity as minus t over here. Okay. So this plane in the front intersects the x-axis at 1. It intersects the t-axis at the y-axis at 0, because it's parallel to the y-axis, and it intersects the t-axis at minus 1. So we call this 1, 0, bar 1, 0, and it's very simple, because the fourth index that you introduce, I, is simply minus h minus k. Okay. So if you want to convert from a 3-index notation to a 4-index notation, then you simply add a third index, which is equal to minus h minus k. And now you can see that the 4-index notation gives you the same, gives you a permutation of the same set of numbers. In other words, they all look like crystallographically equivalent planes. You have 1, 0 bar 1, 0 corresponding to 1, 0, 0, 0, 1 bar 1, 0, and 1 bar 1, 0, 0 for the third plane. So when you look at the literature on hexagonal crystals, you know, books or papers, etc., they will use 4-index notation, not 3-index notation. Okay? Have you come across this before? Okay. What, in the part 1A course?
No, just.
Okay. Okay, so now here we have the stereographic projection drawn using 4-index notation for plane normals. So this is the basal plane here. This is the normal to the front face here. Okay. And then this is the normal, this is the normal to this face, and this one to the one at the back over there. So they all look as if they have the same permutation of 4 numbers. So that's the hexagonal crystal. Hexagonal lattice. Everyone happy with that? Okay. Okay. Now we have the final complication. All right. Final small complication is that we really like the Wise-Zone rule. Okay. And the Wise-Zone rule says that, you know, if you have a direction u v w which lies in a plane h k l, then h u plus k v plus l w will equal 0. But we've introduced a fourth index now, I, which is equal to minus h minus k, and we want to preserve the Wise-Zone rule. So if I write capital U, V, J, and W as the 4-index notation for directions, right, then I need to design that 4-index notation for directions such that the Wise-Zone rule still applies, that h into capital U plus k into capital V plus I into capital J plus L into capital W will give me 0 if that direction lies in that plane. And once again, we write J as equal to minus U minus V. Okay. So we've got these two conditions here, and this is now the Wise-Zone rule for the 4-index notation with the index I replaced by minus h minus k. Okay. So you know the plane is h k I l, and all we've done is replace the index I by minus h minus k, and I'm taking h out as a common factor and k out as a common factor, so I get h into u minus j plus k into v minus j plus l w equals 0, and I compare that with the 3-index rule, hu plus kv plus lw equals 0, and you see that so the relationship between the 4-index notation for directions and the 3-index notation for directions becomes clear by comparing those two Wise-Zone rules, that capital U minus capital J will equal small u, and so on. Okay. Right. Now, you've got a table in your book summarizing these relationships, all right? that how to convert between four index notation for directions and three index notation for directions. And here are the edges of the cell represented as directions. So the 100 direction, which is here in three index notation, becomes 1/3 2 bar 1 bar 1 0. So if I move 2 along here and then I move minus 1 along t here and minus 1 along y, then I recover the 100 direction, but I have to divide by 3 to get the same magnitude. Okay, so that's the physical picture for the four index notation. Now, I wouldn't expect you to remember the rule for the directions. Okay, this is just to help you to understand the literature and books, etc., which will use four index notation for hexagonal systems. Okay.